Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here. I apologize, I'm not able to speak your language. I did do some exercises, but I didn't come further than Jo regelt kivanok. And I hope that the pronunciation is okay. But good morning. I'm very happy to be here. What I'll try to do in the next half hour is to share with you some of the things that we are doing in what we call smart healthcare, where digitization is really the thing that makes the difference. Unfortunately, I could not understand everything that was said before, but what I did understand is that there was a focus on the challenges. I will come back to that, of course, because in what we are doing, and let me be very open on that, digitization, the digital approach, is a means to an end. And the end, of course, is to address challenges in the healthcare system. So we need to understand them, and we need to know what we can do to address those challenges. So I will share some of the information on that. Another message that I will try to convey is that to change healthcare, to transform healthcare, I think that's a good way to phrase it, is a lengthy process. A very complex world, a complex world with many stakeholders that need all to work together. And in the examples I will give, I will show some of that, what is needed to introduce these innovations in healthcare, which is actually very slow to adopt the opportunities of the digital world. And that is a challenge we have to face as well. Yesterday already was here and shared a lot of our thinking, but also was very much inspired by excellent clinicians, excellent academic groups here in Budapest, but also people from Page that came here and others. And I think there's lots of opportunities really to make a difference. And what I will end with is also a description or an introduction, if you like, to EIT Health, an organization recently started that can really help us to join forces to transform healthcare in Hungary and actually in Europe. So with that, the challenges. And I think what I understood in the speeches before already, a number of them were mentioned. The increase of lifespan that we have at the moment. But at the same time, as a result of that, the big challenges in offering adequate healthcare solutions, the cost associated with that. When we get older, we are confronted with chronic disease, and it's very cost-intensive to treat people with chronic disease. Shortage of doctors globally, a very big problem. And actually digitization, telehealth, e-health enabled by digitization is certainly an answer to that that challenge. And I would say that Hungary is no exception to the rest of the world. And actually if you focus on the life expectancy, of course we live longer, and I think that was also the slide that you showed. Sorry to repeat some of that, but I think it's important to really realize that while we're living longer, the big challenge is the fact that we live longer with a lot of disabilities, with chronic conditions. Easily that can be a decade. And one of the ambitions that we have in Europe is to increase the healthy lifespan by 2 years for every European citizen, for instance, in the European Innovation Partnership for Active and Healthy Aging. And as you can see here, in Hungary, we can do things as well, but I would say that this is true across Europe. So the question I would like to address is, where are we now in the healthcare system? What can we do to basically to create the future? How can we transform healthcare? How can we leverage the digital opportunities to make the healthcare system better? And it's not just a matter of technology, but it's also a matter of mindset, of working together, of collaboration. And of course, the challenge is to get better care at lower cost, because we have to contain the cost of the healthcare system. And the answer to that is what we think, digital healthcare, leveraging digitization in healthcare. At the same time, and I cannot emphasize that enough, healthcare is not about digitization, but digitization is an aid to realize the innovations in healthcare, where healthcare very much is a people business. So you don't want to be helped by a computer. You don't want to be given advice by a computer. You want to have also human contact, because healthcare is not about data, about figures, about graphs, but it's really also to make choices together, to enable us as patients also to make the right choices, where digitization is a help, but it's not the solution, not the only solution. So what are the three key elements in this? First of all, what we call the Internet of Things, the fact that actually all equipment that we have that is producing data in the meantime is connected, that we can use information coming out of these systems to do a better job. Quality of data, very important, I will come back to that. Second, of course, big data, lots of information that we have to deal with, but also that we can use. And third, also extremely important, is the knowledge. It's not just the data, but you need to know in what context they are generated and how to use them. And what we describe there is the what we call the virtual physiological human, the understanding of the processes in the body, starting with the DNA, translation through RNA into the proteins, into processes that take place in our body, and basically use that insight to do a better job. And I will give also an example of that. So what will the digital revolution in healthcare do? It will do two things. What we call industrialization, it will make healthcare, I would say, more controllable. Yeah? You can support the stakeholders in the healthcare system to do a better and more controlled job, because you know what you're doing, you can register that, and we can provide tools to do that. And second is to use it to make it more personal. And that, of course, is what healthcare is about. It's about personalization. Personalization, many times used as an example of using data to, I would say, provide more precise treatment for a particular patient, but at the same time using tools to share the information with the patient so that you can together do a better job in making choices, making the choices personal. A key element there is connectivity. Sharing information with the stakeholders, empowering patients by sharing the information to take an active role in their own care, connecting data, hospitals, very complex organizations, many departments. Digitization helps to connect those departments in the hospital, but also helps the hospital as a complex organization where there's a lot of knowledge to reach out to decentral locations, to reach out to secondary and primary care, to the patient and the patient's environment to do a better and more effective job. So connectivity and digital go hand in hand. Now a little bit about Philips. I'm not going to make advertisement here because I'm in the research, I'm not selling anything. But what is important to understand, and this is not only in Philips, but also in many of the other companies active in this area, is we started very much with hardware. 100 years ago we started with X-ray. At that time it was a device business, and business built on hardware. Then software was added, but at the moment we are in the process of using the combination of hardware and software and translating that into solutions and services, working together with all the stakeholders in the field. What is very important in that journey is to be able to use clinical data, personal data, in a good way. And therefore we have created a system, what we call HealthSuite Digital Platform, to do that. Because the data that we're talking about are sensitive data. It's data about us, about our health. And we don't want to put that somewhere on the internet without having control. And so we really have to come up with solutions that enable us to use these very personal and clinical data. And there's a lot of rules and considerations around that, rightfully so. So we build this digital platform, which basically enables us to work in a secure environment together with our partners to use the data. It's an open platform, so it means that others can use that as well. And the ambition that we have with that platform is really to enable going into the digital healthcare world. And a number of things I already mentioned, it's secure, very important for healthcare data. It's collaborative, it supports connectivity, and it provides an open source and open structure so that we can really work together. A little bit zooming in, and this actually emphasizes that basically it's based on digitization, on data, but what is very important is to make the structure such that it supports the things I just mentioned. It supports collaboration, we call the collaboration cloud. It supports the Internet of Things, connecting to the devices, what we call the connected device cloud, so that we can read out information from the devices, of course, fully endorsed by and supported with informed consent, if it's about patient data, and therefore the secure data cloud, yeah, to make sure that we deal with the data in a responsible manner. And of course then the applications are manifold for our user experiences, for our applications, as well as for those of others. So HSDP is really enabling the integrated solutions. What I will do now is go a little bit into the requirements of and challenges of big data in healthcare, and I will give a couple of examples. Important is to realize what we call the data lifecycle. It starts with data, but of course the data are means to an end. So we want to make sure that the data are good, are trustworthy, so we clean the data. Sometimes there are missing data that we need to address. You integrate and federate the data, you do analysis, and in the end you want to support interpretation and use. So it's about a combination of hardware, the platforms and the tools that you provide, but in the end it's about also deriving advanced algorithms so that you can provide help to the user to use the data effectively. And there's a number of steps that we are making. First step, of course, is descriptive, just to show what has happened, to learn from that. In the end, what you would like to do is go for prescriptive, so that you can give indications of what will happen, so to project into the future. This, of course, complex and requires a lot of clinical insight, clinical trial. Intermediate step is predictive. Advanced analytics is, of course, the key thing to connect the three. And advanced analytics is also something that we are really investing in together with our partners. Because the advanced analytics will only work when you work together with the people who have the insights, the knowledge, to translate data into meaningful information. The data challenges I will briefly mention, because it's not easy to make the digital transformation in healthcare, and all these five considerations need to be considered. Dealing with the volume, velocity, the variety, so the disparity of data that you want to use and should use, veracity, the trustworthiness of the data, the security of the data, particularly in healthcare, extremely important. And of course, I will give the examples under the topic of valuation. Big data and Philips, so we are creating already a lot of data. So we are a big company, a multinational company with, I would say, a portfolio across the healthcare domain. And I will use these examples to address the five needs, the five considerations in big data and healthcare. First of all, focusing on volume. We are one of the largest companies creating images, radiological images in the world, and they already are there. We can use them. We can connect to our instrumentation through the Internet of Things, and we can use that information in real time to provide feedback to the user, basically to do a better job in managing the radiology lab, to increase the efficacy and the efficiency and the quality of the outcomes generated there. That's what we actually are already doing. It is happening now. All our big iron, all our imaging equipment is connected and we use that. Next step we are going to take, and that is a step from descriptive, and this is very much descriptive, to predictive. The end goal is really to use the information and the insights we have to do predictive maintenance, to foresee that in the future some parts in our equipment may need replacement or is functioning suboptimal. Before the user notices it, we can already come in and, for instance, change the part or optimize the equipment. And that means that actually we, in this way, we will be able to guarantee more or less 24/7 optimal use of the equipment, using data, using connectivity, really to predict outcomes and use that for the benefit of our customers. Velocity, very exciting, because there, of course, we leverage that as a company, we both create the data, and we have the hardware, we can dig into the hardware, get the data out, also raw data, and use them in real time to do a better job. You don't want to do a lot of analysis and then call your patient later. You want to know the information when you are facing the patient, or you want to know the information while you're executing a minimal invasive surgery using interventional X-ray. And that can only be done when you really have real-time data, when you can add velocity. And velocity, of course, depends on communication. It also depends on, I would say, the bandwidth of the 4G, soon 5G, maybe future quantum computing that you can leverage to do a more and more effective job. Variety of data. And there I will go into one example, because that is very close to my heart. I'm very much focusing on this topic at the moment, is how can we improve decision taking in cancer care? Cancer care, very complex. It's a set of diseases. It's many diseases, depending on the organ, depending on the origin of the disease and what you can do about it. And because it's so complex, because you need a lot of information to do a good diagnosis, because there's a lot of people involved also in providing therapy, pharmaceutical therapy, radiotherapy, surgery, making decisions in this field is very complex, and it has, of course, a major impact on the patient. So also the challenge of bringing all that information together to inform the patient is very important. And we have done a lot of workshops, created insights together with our customers, really to analyze where are the issues. And in many cases, the issues are already at the level of the descriptive data challenge. Because the information is there, it's at different locations, so even to share the data effectively, bring it together effectively, also already has a major impact on the quality of care, to avoid avoidable errors, because information is not there when you need to take the decision, for instance. And there's a lot that we can do to make cancer care more effective, more efficient, and of higher quality, to really improve on cancer care just by sharing the information, to offer integrated informations and integrated data. Here a picture of the cancer mortality rate. And I think there's a lot that we can do to improve outcomes in Europe, particularly also in Hungary. We have to do also a deep dive, I think, here to see, to understand what we can do to improve cancer care here. But also information sharing, without doubt, is a major contributor. So what we are developing is what we call definitive diagnostics. Imaging, of course, a starting point. You have to locate the position of the tumor. Are there metastases? Very important, which you can do with, of course, with imaging tools as well. Use that information to do a precise biopsy. Go in with a needle under image guidance so that you really get the tumor out, because that is the source of the therapeutic decision taking. You have to understand what is causing the tumor to grow and what you can do about it, and whether it's possible really to remove it completely because of the location of the tumor. Very important new development that we have introduced, actually completely developed within Philips Research, introduced on the market about 2 years ago, digital pathology. Really getting the same kind of information in the digital form as we have in imaging at the moment. Crucial to make more objective decisions possible, to share data also remotely, do telepathology, have an expert maybe sitting in London or Oxford, look at your pathology data and get advice, particularly when it's a rare cancer, a project that we are developing in EIT Health, for instance. And genomics, of course. Revolution in genomics, and of course, cancer is a disease of the genes, so the solution also for the treatment you can find in the genes, in the changes, the modifications in the genes, identification of individual pathways. First step, descriptive, is putting all the information together and make it accessible, share it, creating a dashboard that can be used by the oncologist, in this case, example for prostate cancer. And also, let me see whether I have a pointer, not only to provide this information coming out of the different sources I just described, but also on the basis of that, making a prognosis, a prediction of what happens or may happen to the patient depending on the treatment that is provided, based on knowledge that we have on treatment outcomes. This is a first step. And then, of course, in the future, we hope to become prescriptive because we understand everything. But this is a long path because of the complexity of the disease. But we are taking first steps to get there. Just to indicate the complexity, this is the picture of what can happen, the workflow for a prostate cancer patient coming in here on the left and actually at some point, I would say, getting out on the right. And I indicated the main decision points that we are focusing on, because in practice, only 5 out of 6 patients, sorry, 1 out of 6 patients with prostate cancer dies of the disease. 5 out of 6 people, men with prostate cancer, die of other causes. So it's very important to know which people need to be treated, also because there's a lot of potential downsides to the treatment. Very important decisions to be taken. So it's not always a decision on the treatment. Sometimes, in many cases, it's a decision about not treating, which is very important as well from a point of view of cost. Veracity, very important topic. I could spend hours on that because it's really in turning from where we are now in healthcare to the digital world of healthcare, trust by all the stakeholders is extremely important. And there, because decisions are based on that, the veracity of the data, the authenticity, the security, the provenance is essential. The reliability of the data. Sometimes people say, well, big data, if you have enough data, you don't have to be very accurate. However, you have to realize that a decision on an individual patient is based on the data that are available. What we can do, again, Internet of Things, we can remotely do authentication of the information, we can control the instrumentation so that we are sure that the data is robust and trustworthy, and we can check the quality of the data. And we can indicate the quality of the data as well. So we can really leverage, again, digitization to provide comfort and trust of the usefulness of the approach. Also remotely. And finally, the value. I already gave the example of cancer, very challenging because of the disparate data sources that you need to integrate. I would like to end with, I would say, kind of other example where we are moving from the hospital into the home with data that help treat and manage people's health also in decentralized locations. And I start with the patient monitoring. Philips is the world leader in patient monitoring in the ICU, so we know everything about patient monitoring, monitoring of vital signs, and you have to think about cardiac parameters, but also blood gases, basically all the information that you need to basically manage the health of a patient in hospital. And that is all connected. It's plug and play. Information is shared. It's remote. It's already working. Now the next step is to really close the loop. To put in our knowledge. I mentioned virtual physiological human, the insights that we can bring into the picture. So the physiological background knowledge together with our partners. Really use that information to do more intelligent management of the patient in the ICU, intelligent alarms, foreseeing problems, doing predictive alarming, so that you can see, well, this patient is deteriorating, maybe this patient is going into sepsis, the major cause of death in the ICU. And then, of course, communicating, sharing the information with physician and nurse. And, of course, closing the loop and really learning while doing to improve how we manage patients in the ICU. And this is ongoing now. This is commercially available even. Now, this knowledge we take outside of the ICU into the general ward, but in the end we want to use similar information, similar very much based on the insights in how a human body is functioning, really to do a better job also in the home and really help people manage their health in hospital but also outside. Yesterday we had also a very interesting visit to the sports university, using that information actually also to improve on the quality of the life of athletes, of the performance of athletes, but also use that information to do a better job with us, normal and common citizens. This is what we are taking now into the ward. Of course, their requirements are different. You don't want to be in a ward and being surrounded by all kinds of instruments and cables and whatnot that you have in the ICU. So you have to come up with new solutions, new technologies to enable that. And it's a combination of these hardware solutions, connectivity, and integration and interpretation of data that I showed in the beginning. At the same time, it's extremely important to analyze the outcomes. And we are living in a world where we move to value-based healthcare. So we have to understand when we do an intervention, what does it mean for the quality of care and the clinical outcome for the patient, but also the economic outcome. And there, of course, in the kind of world that we are describing now, this connected world with different stakeholders, it's important to work together with partners that can really transcend the boundaries and really think in a futuristic way. And we have a number of these collaborations, and one of them is shown here. What we try to do here is to do predictive analytics, foreseeing a problem in the general ward based on the advanced analysis of the vital signs that we are measuring. And so really, the ambition is rather than wait for the final alarm, to analyze the trend of the data so that we can indicate the patient is starting to deteriorate. You have to have a look at the patient and see what you can do to avoid complications. In many cases, actually, people die in general wards because they're not effectively monitored and overseen, and we can make a real difference there. Together with Celebration Health, which is an accountable care organization in the US, so basically it's an organization in which tertiary, secondary, and primary care are combined, are in one organization. We have done a trial and have actually proven that we can realize a huge improvement in recording deterioration in the general ward. And that, of course, translates into saving lives, but also in saving cost. Because if there's a complication and you move from the general ward to the ICU, a lot of cost is incurred. ICU is, of course, a very expensive place to be. And we have done this analysis in great detail and it has been published. Last example, using this knowledge to move out of the hospital, out of a controlled environment, to the home. And of course, that is very challenging. There is also, together with an accountable care organization, Banner Health, also in the US, in Utah, we have developed what we call the combination of an e-care coordinator and an e-care companion. E-care coordinator, a dashboard for the healthcare professional in the hospital or in the home. E-care companion, a dashboard for the patient. As a result of bringing this knowledge, and of course with again with appropriate tools, devices, and appropriate connectivity, we're able to make a big difference in quality of life and cost of healthcare in this case. Really addressing the need to come up with solutions for patients with chronic disease. Now I'm moving to the end of the presentation. I hope I've shown that there's lots of opportunities, but there's also challenges. And these challenges can only be addressed when we are working together in what we call co-creation, together with all the stakeholders in the healthcare system. It's about transforming the healthcare system. It's also about coming up with new business models, new approaches to basically introduce these innovations together with the stakeholders. The focus, however, is shifting. Shifting from healthcare, I would say addressing disease, to preserving quality of life, good quality of life. Very important. And that is also the ambition that we have in EIT Health. EIT actually has its headquarters in Budapest. EIT Health has its headquarters in Munich, but also has a very important presence, and we'll come back to that in a minute, here in Budapest as well. And the focus there is healthy living and active aging, improving the quality of life, improving the healthy lifespan of European citizens. And that is also the mission of EIT Health. That's only possible when we put people together. When we put people together, people from industry, academic, researchers, clinical researchers, and of course also the public health, the public health system, because that is responsible for the provision of health. And also in the introduction, I heard about small and medium enterprises play an extremely important role because they're able to come up with new ideas and new concepts, and they have also a very important and prominent place in EIT Health and are also a very important part of the ecosystem, developing smart products and smart solutions. EIT Health is a partnership across Europe. Actually, Philips has been one of the initiators. Actually, I started with the first initiative called InnoLife in 2007. So it has taken some time to get where we are now with start about a year ago. Here we have InnoStars, and Balázs Furjas is somewhere in the audience. I saw him just now, so maybe you can contact him here for local support and information. It would be maybe good if you stand up. If you're he's a modest guy. He doesn't want to stand up. But so everybody knows you. Okay, good. He is there. He is in front. So really you can contact him for all kinds of information, and we are very happy, and we already started a number of discussions yesterday to work with the ecosystem here in Hungary to really change the world of healthcare, to transform the healthcare and move forward together with you, because that is what it's about. Collaboration and co-creation is the only way to leverage the digital revolution in healthcare to support the transformation. This is the summary. I'm not going to read it out because you have hopefully got all the messages that I gave before. And I would like to close with one slide that I found very inspiring. And I discovered actually this information yesterday afternoon. And it's also, I think, very descriptive of what is the challenge that we're facing, but also the way in which we need to engage in that. Because, as I said in the beginning, transforming healthcare is not easy. There's a lot of stakeholders that maybe now not all aligned, and we need perseverance, we need motivation, we really need the power to change the world in healthcare, and we have to do that all in an ethical way, because it's about us. It's about our data, our information, our life, and we have to take that serious. Thank you.